will take around one minute. I will say yes. Will take around one minute.
So now we can start, please.
Okay. Good evening and welcome to all for this today's lecture on glaciers as a source of water. And this is again.
So now we can start, please.
Okay. There is some echo, it seems. Okay. So good evening and welcome to all for today's lecture on glaciers as a source of water.
Please YouTube link ko mute pe kar
lijiye. YouTube link ko band kar dijiye sir.
Mobile thoda dur rakh do apna, nahi to.
Okay. So this on today's lecture, glaciers as a source of water, and this initiative has been taken by the ITRA under the program of this water management lecture series, and it has been inaugurated by our chief guest Professor Ajit Chaturvedi, Director of IIT Roorkee, along with our guest of honor Professor Sudhir Jain, Director IIT Gandhinagar. And as this lecture began with on 16th of January, and then it started with groundwater resources, and then following up the future of rivers in India, then interlinking of river and wastewater and its treatment. So if you see the titles of the presentation, so it covers a different aspect of the water and how we have to use judiciously the available water and maintaining the sustainability so that it can be properly used or availed in our future. And seeing this climate change scenario, and in this lecture series, ITRA has made an attempt to touch different aspect of water. So with this, I again welcome all of you for participating in this lecture. And now, as this you may be aware that this lecture will be presented by D. Ram Rajak, who is working at Space Application Center. And for more introduction or to get a better insight of his work profile, I request Shri Himanshu Tushar to introduce our speaker to the our participants. Himanshu, please.
Yeah. Thank you, Sushil sir. Thank you very much. Before Dr. Rajak starts, I will give you a brief intro about Dr. Rajak. Dr. D. Ram Rajak completed his ME in civil from IIT Roorkee in 1990 and joined Space Applications Center ISRO Ahmedabad in 1991. He completed his PhD in the field of operations management. Currently, he is head of geosciences division at Space Applications Center ISRO Ahmedabad, and his primary area of research is geoscience studies using satellite-based Earth observation data. He participated in 33rd Indian expedition to Antarctica in the year of 2013-14, Arctic expedition in March 2019, and lead two Himalayan expeditions to Khardungla and Chippa glaciers. Earlier, coordinated a national scale program forecasting agricultural output using space, agro, meteorology, and land-based observation, that is FASAL, supported in techniques development for operationalization of FASAL, which was transferred to Ministry of Agriculture. He has successfully completed many projects on remote sensing applications as project principal investigator at SAC ISRO since 1991. And there are 50 plus publications in the form of papers in journals and symposium, along with scientific articles, book, atlas, etc. He is secretary of ISRSAC from 2020 to 22 and past secretary of IMSA from 2016 to 18. He is member of many professional societies, including ISRS, ISG, IMS, ISSE, and ASI. He also organized an international and a national symposia as organizing secretary. He is recipient of several awards and recognitions, include University Gold Medal from IIT Roorkee in 1991, ISRO Team Award in 2007 as a member of CAPE Team, GIS Development Geospatial Excellence Award in 2009 as a member of FASL Team, Best Paper Presentation in 2008 in INCA International Congress, Best Paper Award in 2012 in ISRS 2012 Symposium, Best Paper Poster in ISG ISRS National Symposium 2018, etc. And that's a brief about our today's speaker. Now I request Dr. Rajak, please proceed further.
Thank you, dear Himanshu. Good evening to everyone. First of all, I take this opportunity to thank IITRA Ahmedabad. I thank Sri A.C. Mathurji and all the IITRA EC members who have given this opportunity to share my views on glaciers as a source of water with you all. So I again thank everyone and good evening to all the participants. Some echo is coming.
YouTube link, I request all the members to keep it on mute. YouTube link is open on any other device.
Okay, so I will start again. The talk, today's talk is on glaciers as a source of water. Okay, this presentation will cover following things. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, please. Okay. Thank you. We will be covering what is a glacier and do we really know glaciers? Then how were these glaciers formed? How many types of glaciers are there? Where the glaciers are found, whether in India or in world everywhere? Why are glaciers important for human beings, for flora and fauna? How much water is there in glaciers? Why are glaciers melting? And we will touch upon some climate change issues. Then how do we use remote sensing data? And what next? What we have to do? So first of all, let us start with what is a glacier? So before I tell anything about glacier, first of all, let us know what is the difference between snow, ice, and sea ice. So snow is a porous and permeable aggregate of ice crystals. We all have seen snow. Mostly we have seen snow in natural format, and we have seen artificial snow also. Whenever we go to any snow park, or if you have gone to any ski park there, you might have seen that they prepare snow artificially also. And then what is sea ice? Sea ice is nothing but it has a frozen layer of sea or ocean water. So now these are the two major difference between snow and sea ice. One is formed over land because of the natural precipitation, and another, that is sea ice, is formed over the water itself. So you can say top layer of water when it is frozen, that is sea ice. Now what is ice? So ice is basically formed from snow itself. Because of the densification of snow, ice is formed. So snow undergoes rapid changes in grain size and shape. Now what is glacier? Glacier is basically ice. The word glacier is coined from the Latin word glacis, which means ice. Now as far as the definition is concerned, so I have written some of the definitions of glacier, like Mayer definition. First definition he gave in 1994. As for this definition, a body of ice. Later on he had modified it, that large mass of perennial ice originating on land by the recent crystallization of snow or other form of solid precipitation, showing evidence of past or present flow. So that moment has to be there. Either that moment can be currently it is available, or at least there should be some evidence that there was some movement in the past. The Knight in 1999 gave a definition: a huge mass of ice slowly flowing over a landmass formed from compacted snow in an area where snow accumulation exceeds melting and sublimation. So now you can see that more terms of are coming and things are becoming more and more clear. Kuhn in 2010 gave a definition, or rather he explained it. The main principle for the glacier presence over a region is that winter snowfall should be sufficiently high and the temperature should not be more than 0°C. Due to the presence of excessive snowfall and snow accumulation during consecutive years. Now you see the time domain is coming into the picture. Glaciers usually tend to form in extreme cold and wet conditions. Now you can see this left side, that how snow over the time and because of densification, or you can say because of the it's because of its own weight, how snowflake convert in granule of snow, then with densification it converts in fern. Basically fern is a stage between snow and ice, and that fern further densification it becomes glacier ice. So now we know that because of the physical changes, snow gets converted in ice. Okay, now the participants, let me know whether this is a reversible process or irreversible process. You can write your answer in chat box. Now, before I go and tell detail about the glacier, let us know something about water, because it has got some unique characteristics. We know that usually material becomes denser when they solidify, correct? But water becomes lighter when it solidifies. So it has got this unique characteristics. You may not be knowing many material which has got this characteristic. And just imagine what would have been the earth because of this special characteristic of the water. What would have been the effect if this characteristic is not there on water creatures, on fishes, effect on human being, its activities, effect on flora and fauna, and effect on our entire environment. So that, you just imagine what would have been the earth. The fact that water reaches a maximum density at around 4°C, it causes bodies of water to freeze on the top first. If freezing starts from bottom of water, then what will happen? Just imagine and you will come to know that maybe that life would not have existed over the earth. Now, thing is that what happens between 4 degree and 0 degree Celsius? Because we know that fresh water freezes at 0 degree, or you can say that ice melts at 0 degree. So now, I will not be going in the detail, but I will tell the structure of water molecule and its properties. Basically, they govern what is, as I told you, that it has got maximum density at 4 degrees Celsius. Salinity, temperature, they also play an important role in deciding the freezing point. So now this is something which I wanted to share with you, that what is special about water characteristics. Now let us come back to the glaciers. Why this is not going? Okay, my heading is not visible because of that menu. Okay, so here I wanted to show that, because we know that glaciers are there for decades, for centuries, for thousands of years, but I wanted to show that some glaciers are very young also. So this, I am showing one of the youngest glacier, or rather the youngest glacier of the earth. This glacier's name is Crater Glacier. It is in US, and it basically started forming after 1980 only. Usually we think that all the glaciers are, you know, thousands of years, and some of the glaciers are millions of years if you talk about the Greenland and Antarctica, but it's not like that. Even some glaciers are there some centuries old also. So this is the place. You can see there is one St. Helens Mound, and about around that there is glacier. And these are some of the pictures which I have taken from the internet. This is another pic which is showing that, you know, ice is there. And again, how with the time, because, you know, this is the duration which we have got photographed. You will not get this kind of photograph or other glaciers. So this St. Helens Mountain, you can see on October 1980. This, right now there is no glacier around it. But then 1984, some volcanic eruption happened there. You can see the plume. And later on, circumstances changed that glaciation started there. You can see Crater Glacier in 2000 and 2006. And earlier picture you have already seen. These are basically recent pictures. So this is all about the youngest glacier. Now I will show you, if I see what is the deepest and thickest alpine temperate glacier over the earth. It is this glacier. This is Taku Glacier. Now I was going through that, where are the largest glaciers. So you know that Lambert Glacier over Antarctica, that is considered the largest glacier, and our Siachen Glacier in Himalaya, that is considered the largest glacier after basically if you leave all the polar glaciers. Okay, so non-polar glacier, that is the largest glacier, Siachen Glacier. And if I see what is the fastest moving glacier, because as I told you that glaciers are moving body, they are not stagnant, they are not standing there. So simple question comes, what is the fastest flowing glacier? So this Jacobsen Glacier, which is there in Greenland, it is basically fastest moving glacier. Its average speed is more than 12 kilometers per year. That kind of flow is happening there. It is picture of that. Now, so much I have told about some glacier, but really, do we know the glaciers? No. If we have to know the glacier, we have to understand its different elements. like, so some of the elements I will be discussing, like plucking and abrasion. What is plucking and abrasion? This is an alpine glacier. And you can see this is ice and this is bedrock. Now, here you can see this extending flow. Because of high gradient here, this ice is moving fast. And wherever that gradient is not high, there will be compressive flow. Flow will be basically, you can say tensile type of flow, and you can say compression type of flow. So there are two kinds of flow, and because of that, you can see formation of ice fall, you can see formation of crevasses. I will show you what all these things are. What is a crevasse? I will show you that. And due to plucking and abrasion, whatever material from the bedrock or the sidewalls of any alpine glacier is carried with glacier, that is deposited at the end or sometimes along the side of the glacier flow. That is basically called moraine. We will be discussing more about moraine. Okay. Now, type of moraines. Terminal moraine, what is terminal moraine? It is a deposit of till that mark the farthest advance of glacier. For example, if this glacier is ending here, I think you can see the my cursor. If this is ending here and some moraine is deposited here, this is basically the terminal moraine. Now, what are recessional moraines? Moraine deposits created during the halt in the retreat of a glacier. If this glacier is suppose retreating means going back. Okay, at time T1, if this glacier is up to here, you can see my cursor. And after some time, suppose if it retreated up to this place, but there also some moraine will be deposited, then that kind of moraine is known as recessional moraine. Then lateral moraine, as I told, that the moraine deposited along the side walls of valley, side slope, that is called lateral moraines. And medial moraine, when medial moraine, basically it is, you can say, almost in middle of the glacier, but how it will come there in middle and from where it will come. So let us see this picture. Like one glacier is coming from this side and another glacier is coming from this side. So this glacier, after when these two glaciers are joined, this glacier is called main glacier and they are basically called tributary glaciers. Now, this the lateral moraine of this glacier, when it is coming here, this will become the medial moraine because now it is in middle of the glacier. And the moraine which is on side, they are called lateral moraines. Okay, so these are some of the terminology which we need to know whenever we are studying glaciers. Now glaciers are formed here. You can see this right side picture and this ridge of bedrock where there are two sides. And between these two sides, there is bedrock ridge. This is called arete. And when there are more than three arates meeting at one point, that is called horn. This you can see top point. Then glacier melts when they go down the hill and they melt away and there they form pro-glacial lake. This is one picture showing pro-glacial lake. And this left bottom is showing one picture of crevasse. Crevasse, you can say they are basically cracks, but these are very big cracks. That is called crevasse. You can have idea that these people are standing there and this crack, you can see, this is a crevasse. Now, there are other examples of crevasses. This is also one picture. Source I have written an example of crevasse. This is another, now you can see there are so many crevasses and because of crevasses and flow, this basically this glacier is disintegrating, and later on after disintegrating, if there is water, it will melt away in that water, and that is how basically that loss of glacier ice happens. This is one picture which I have taken from Google Earth because I wanted to show you some other features. Now, if you see this area, this is basically upper portion of the mountain, this portion where cirque is written. This cirque is basically is in the portion, which portion is called accumulation area. Accumulation area is what? The region where all input in terms of precipitation is coming. Okay, so wherever snow is falling, but there is no avalanche, there is no melting, that area is called accumulation area. And this is one glacier. It is flowing down here. This is downside. Okay, this medial moraine is written. Now, this is the region where melting happens during summer. Okay, this region is called avalanche region. And this is main glacier, and these three glaciers basically where cirque is written, and these glaciers here, they are tributary glaciers. Okay. Now, one important thing is glacier mass balance. Mass balance is that how much input is there and how much output is there. Now, if input is more and output is less, that mass balance will be positive. Okay. And if precipitation is less, means input is less, and output means in terms of melting or sublimation is more, then mass balance will become negative. Okay. Now, how are glaciers formed? So this picture is showing one glacier. Now, there are, you can say in general, three minimum conditions which should prevail, then only a glacier will form. That cold and local climate. Now, this may be polar region or the high elevation. So that cold local climate has to be there. Then snow must be abundant. Now, how abundant? That more snow must fall than melt. Now, melting is happening during the summer, and snowfall is happening during the winter. Now, snow must not be removed by avalanche or wind. Suppose if there is snow, and if it is, all the snow is removed because of avalanche or because of wind, then there will not be basically accumulation. So these are the three minimum conditions which define that yes, this glacier may be formed. Now, this is one picture which is showing different parts of glacier. Unsaturated snow and fern, this top portion. And this bottom portion basically saturated fern, and later on that basically become glacier ice. Okay, then I have already shown crevasses, and there is one more word which is written moline. Moline are basically, they are, you can say, hole where melt water will enter into, and it will go to the subsurface of glacier. Now, whatever I have told, if anyone knows, then he may write one question is written, when were glaciers formed? I will tell you later on, but participants, if they know when glaciers, most of the glaciers formed, they can write in chat box. Now, so far, whatever we have discussed, we know that glacier is a system itself. When we considered it is a system, it has got certain inputs, it has got certain outputs, it has got certain processes. And due to those processes, input is basically becoming output. So now if we take input accumulation, now it can be rain, it can be hail, it can be snow, then this can be wind-blown snow, basically which was not precipitated there, but from somewhere it has come. Then there can be snow which has come there due to avalanche. or it may be for earth frost. Because of some certain conditions, instead of snow, that becomes hoar earth frost. So these are different inputs. Now there are certain processes, and because of those processes, it moves downward, and what happens? There happens ablation. Ablation may be in terms of melt. Now, along with that, there can be wind blown snow. These are basically output. Then there can be loss of snow because of avalanche, and lots of snow and ice because of sublimation. That you can say direct evaporation from snow to that water vapor. Now there can be surface melt water. Basically, surface melt is because there is heat in bedrock. So that heat basically will turn some ice into water. That is surface melt water, and that will slowly go down. Then there can be subaerial melt and sublimation also. And if this glacier is basically directly feeding over some water surface means this can be a small, some river, large river. Usually they are not there in rivers. They are usually in sea or ocean. So there can be calving. And because of that calving of this glacier, icebergs are formed. So now this another term is iceberg, which you should know that iceberg and sea ice, they are quite different things. Sea ice formed due to freeze of the top layer of ocean or sea, while icebergs are formed because of the calving or because of the disintegration of the glaciers or ice shelf or ice sheets. I will come and I will discuss about ice sheet and ice shelf later. But when we are talking about the mass balance and accumulation and ablation, there is three terms which we should know. Ablation and accumulation we have seen. Now let us see how their annual cycle is there. Basically there are three things plotted. One is accumulation, another is ablation, and another is net mass flux. So this is basically accumulation season, you can say winter. This is ablation season, you can say summer. And let us see accumulation. So accumulation means precipitation will start at some point. It will reach to maximum. Then it will start coming down. And you can say during the peak of summer, it will be minimum. You can say almost near zero. Then again, it will start increasing. So this is accumulation. And if I draw ablation also, although ablation should have been drawn below zero. If accumulation is above zero, then it will be negative. Ablation will be negative. It should have been drawn below zero. But for simplicity, it is drawn above zero. Just see their pattern. Like from here, ablation is going down. Ablation will become almost zero or minimum during peak winter. Then it will go up. Then you can say during peak summer, it will be maximum. Then again, it will come down. Now, summation of accumulation and summation of ablation. Basically, that will become summation of accumulation and ablation. If I take negative sign with ablation, then that will become net mass flux. So this net mass flux, which is drawn in blue color, this you can see, it is increasing here. And at the time of peak of accumulation, that will also be peak. And during the time of peak of ablation, basically there will be the lowest net mass flux. Basically, these are the things which determine mass balance of the glacier. Now, why mass balance is important? Because we have to see over the time whether glaciers are, size of glacier, you can say volume of glacier is increasing or decreasing. So mass balance is crucial for the survival of glacier. If it is not balanced, then certainly either it will increase or decrease. Now, glaciers, type of glaciers. There are major three types, rather two types I will tell. But okay, three type are, what are three types? I'll tell. One is that glaciers that extend in continuous series, very large series, and moving outward in all directions are called ice sheets. And Greenland ice sheet and Antarctica ice sheet, we have got only two ice sheets. Their size is more than 50,000 square kilometer. But when there is this type of glacier, which is less than 50,000 square kilometer, that is called ice cap. The glaciers confined within a path, like within a valley of mountains, and direct the ice movement are called mountain glaciers or alpine glaciers. Now, glaciers that spread on level ground are on the ocean at the foot of glaciated region, they are called basically piedmont glaciers. Now, when this is terminating on ocean or sea, this is called ice shelf. Now, glacier in the third category, they're like this. Usually, they are not treated separately. They are treated how from, because they are not independent glaciers. They are basically dependent on some other glaciers. So their treatment is also happened with their origin. Now, a complex of mountain glaciers burying much of a mountain range is called ice field. Right now, we have seen ice cap. And here we are talking about ice field. Can someone write in chat box that what is the difference between ice cap and ice field? Now, this is one example of alpine glacier. You can see this is one tributary glacier, another tributary glacier, third tributary, and this is main glacier. You can see these are median moraine, there are lateral moraines. Now, ice sheets. So, as I told you, there are only two ice sheets, Greenland ice sheet and Antarctica. This is 1.7 million square kilometer, and this is 14 million square kilometer. Now, you just imagine how big they are. I have written area of India, that is around 3.3 million square kilometer. So you can say that Greenland ice sheet is almost half of the area of India. And you just imagine how big is Antarctica. And what is the size in terms of depth of ice? So let us see. Here I have shown, just compare Greenland ice sheet and Antarctica ice sheet. You see y-axis, this is 4 kilometers here. On average, Antarctica ice sheet is around 2 kilometers thick. 2 kilometers thick is this one. Okay, and its area is around 14 million kilometers square. So that much ice is there in Greenland ice sheet and Antarctica ice sheet. Now, where are glaciers formed? Where are they found? So they are basically found everywhere, all over the world. You can say all the continent except Australia. And as we know that most of the glaciers are there in polar regions, but there are alpine glaciers near equator also. That is what is written in Ecuador, Kenya, Uganda, which are the countries which are quite near to equator. So glaciers are found there also. Now, how their distribution? So this table shows an approximate distribution of the glacier in the world. So there are glaciers in Africa, Antarctica, as I have told, this is because ice sheet right now we are considering as glacier. Okay. So Antarctica is also there, Greenland is also there. Overall, you will see that around 16 million square kilometer, 15.86, that is the area of glacier, including ice sheets. Now, this is another example. Now, if you see other than this Greenland and Antarctica, where are other glaciers distribution? This is India and these glaciers are there in Himalaya. So this shows that where all over the world glaciers are distributed. Now, if you come to India itself, I have shown some of the major glaciers which are there in Himalaya. They are in different basins. These are the names. Some 24 names of basins are written there. And in various basins, there are number of glaciers. As I told you, Siachen Glacier, which is the largest glacier outside polar region, it is there in Himalaya. Then Chota Sigri, then Naradur, then these are some of the names of those glaciers which are there. You can say many of these glaciers are in India. Now, so we have seen that what are glaciers, how they are formed, where are they found. Now, why these glaciers are important, why we should study. Okay. So the global ice cover has been recurrently expanding and contracting during recent geological time. Now, geological time right now, some 30 million years ago to present. Okay, so we are telling there they are expanding and contracting. If it is happening and if it is a natural process, then why we are worried about or why we are giving so much emphasis for glacier study? The fluctuations influence because geological, climatological and biological environment, they affected the evolution and development of early humans. In a way, you can say whatever we are today, whatever flora and fauna is there around us, it has been modulated by the presence and absence of glacier. There was a time when around 30% of the world land mass was covered by the glaciers. Now, glaciers, when I'm talking glacier here, ice sheet and ice caps, they are included. But today we know that only 10%, around 10% of the area is covered. Now, why glaciers are important? Because we know that glaciers provide drinking water to a large community, because so many rivers are fed by the glaciers and water is coming there, and so many millions of people, their irrigation, their daily routine, and so many things are dependent on glacier water. I have written in detail. Oh, sorry. Why this has come again? Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So glaciers provide drinking water. Then glaciers irrigate crops. As I told you, because so many rivers are fed by glaciers, so lot of area, lot of agriculture, lot of food grain, it is dependent on water which is available from the glaciers. Then you know that glaciers help generate hydroelectric power also. And details are written here. I'm not going to read the details. Now, as I told you, why it is important. So many mountainous parts of the world with a seasonal rainfall, glaciers are a reliable water source in the dry season. And these glaciers can be called basically water towers of the world. And they provide water from glacier melt and orographic rainfall. Now, orographic rainfall, I will not be explaining in detail, but they provide. Now, now we know that temperature is increasing, slowly temperature is increasing. So if I plot time on x-axis and temperature and volume and runoff and different things on y-axis, and there is no scale. So when temperature was, you can say, not increasing, then all these things were relatively stable. Now, when temperature is increasing, here you can see rising air temperature, then what is happening? Declining glacier volumes. glacier's volume is declining, reducing area also. And because of that, the seasonal melt runoff, that is also decreasing. Okay, and peak melt water, that is also decreasing. Now, there is a time, because of melt, high melt, you can say, there is a time will come when the melt water and seasonal melt, they will be at highest level, but because of the reduction in volume of glacier, a time will come that overall annual runoff will decrease and melt season runoff will also decrease. And after certain, maybe centuries, when there will not be any glacier, all these things will again stabilize. So this is basically showing that importance of glacier, that how glaciers are affecting the water resources over the in the world. Now, these are some of more things which tells about the importance of glacier as water resource, that at least 200 million people in the world are in danger of being left without water. These are the sources also I have written. Then disappearing Peruvian glaciers, they are also talking the drastic reduction of almost 30% in the area covered by glaciers between year 2000 and 2016. So there are some parts of the globe where drastic reduction in glacier area and glacier volume is happening. And this reduction is happening because they are melting. But as such, glacier melting is natural thing, but they are melting abnormally. Okay, so glaciers have short response time and therefore react quickly to climate change. And they are currently contributing about 1/3 of the currently observed sea level rise. Sea level rise is another thing which we are worried about. If sea level will increase, there are a number of towns, there are a number of cities, a lot of land which will be submerged because of this increased sea level. The regions currently losing mass fastest are Arctic, Canada, North, then Alaska, and you can say those regions. But it's not that only those areas are affected. Even Asia, even our India is affected. This there is one news which I have shown here, that collapsing glaciers threaten Asia's water supply. Details I'm not going. Now, this is basically another thing which tells that water, world glaciers and ice sheets, they basically how they are melting and what kind of area change are happening, what kind of mass balance. You see these dots are showing where a very small dot, basically their mass balance negative is less. Okay, so negative mass balance is high here. Bigger dot you can see, so that you can see that lot of melting of glacier is happening and area of glacier is reducing there. This is another ice sheet, one ice sheet model which give research insight into potential ice loss in each of the Antarctic ice sheet. Basically, 14 sectors are studied in this one, and in each of the sector, if melt happens in coming 1,000 years, how much sea level will increase? So these, you know, these two are basically ice shelf. Ice shelf are, this is Antarctica. This 97% to 98% of Antarctica is covered by ice. As I told you, average ice thickness is around 2 kilometers. But these parts and some other parts like here also, like there also, they are, you can say, hanging ice sheets. Hanging means there is no ground beneath those ice sheets. So those ice sheets, part of ice sheets are called basically ice shelves. beneath those iceshelf there is ocean. That is why they are called ice shelf. And these are the regions where most affected. Then there are certain glaciers which are also affected. Here is Emery ice shelf. This is also affected. This portion of Antarctica is called Eastern Antarctica. And this is called, this left side you can see, this is basically Western Antarctica. And these different numbers tell, it is based on certain model, bicycles model, that if this in coming 1,000 years, this portion will melt and this much sea level rise will be there. This is showing Ron Isel 2.6 meter, then Amundsen Sea, there will be increase of 2.3 meter. And source of study is written here. Now, let us see why these glaciers are melting abnormally. As I told you earlier, glacier melt is a normal thing, but they are melting abnormally. So, someone will tell because of climate change. But climate change, so let us see what is climate, what is weather, and what is climate change. So, weather we know what, now what is the difference between weather and climate? Climate is basically a statistical thing of weather in spatio-temporal domain. What is right now happening, that is weather. Whether it is temperature, whether it is humidity, that is weather. But when you talk of weather for a long duration and over a region, that is called climate. So what we can say, climate is average weather for a given place or a region. It defines typical weather conditions for a given area based on long-term averages. Now, what is climate change? If I simply tell climate change is a normal thing. Yes, climate keep on changing. If you see in geological scales, there has been a time when there were ice ages, when there were climate was hotter than the current. Then why we tell climate change? Basically, when we tell climate change, we are telling abnormal changes of climate, or you can say the rate of change of climate, that is basically abnormal, and that is climate change we are talking about. Now, how this climate change is studied? So now there are different ways of studying climate change. Like if you see a tree ring, now this, if you can count the ring, number of rings of that tree, and that will give how old that tree is. But if you see the content within those rings, you can come to know what kind of climate or what kind of weather was there during that year when this ring was formed. This is one example. Then we dig ice cores from Greenland ice sheet, from Antarctic ice sheet, and from different glaciers, because that glaciers is centuries old. That glacier ice is thousands of years old. And if you take that ice, you do analysis of that ice, you come to know that what kind of climate was there when that ice was formed. Now, there are certain measurement of climate. But climate means carbon dioxide. Because carbon dioxide is one of the greenhouse gases. I will not be telling in detail what are greenhouse gases, but carbon dioxide is one of the greenhouse gases which affect basically global warming. So now there is measurement, proper measurement mechanism, and it is measured continuously at Mauna Loa Observatory since 1958. And obviously we know now there are number of sensors on board satellites. They also give estimation of some of the gases which really affect the climate. Now here I have shown Mauna Loa Observatory. Here this is India, this is Mauna Loa. This is a small island, this island over there, this Mauna Loa instrument. And this is the world's oldest continuous carbon dioxide monitoring station. It is considered the world's primary benchmark site for measurement of the gas by researchers. Now, let us come to the energy budget. Because we are talking about the climate change, so we know that climate is governed by the how much solar radiation is coming. So this is solar energy. If we consider this is 100 unit, now 100 unit, it is incident over the Earth atmosphere, in the Earth atmosphere. Okay. Now out of this 100, if there is balance, 31, around 31 unit, it is basically reflected back. Okay, this is written short wave portion of the budget. So Earth, because of the Earth's albedo, 31 unit is reflected back. Then 69 unit is absorbed by the atmosphere or the Earth's surface, and later on, it is radiated back to the space. So 31 directly went out of the atmosphere and 69 later on. So the total became 100. So 100 unit came to Earth and 100 unit went back from the Earth. So there is basically balance of the radiation. And if there is balance, then there is nothing to worry. But thing is that this balance is being disturbed. And this is being disturbed due to certain gases that we will see. Now, over the Earth itself, all the surfaces doesn't reflect in a uniform manner. There are certain features like, you know, fresh snow or ice, they reflect more energy. If you see the asphalt or the water body, they reflect very less energy, and there is a lot of absorption. So basically, this determines the albedo of that feature. Like if we see moon, its albedo is 6 to 8%. Now, so where the problem? Whether the greenhouse effect is problem? How greenhouse effect can be a problem? Because that is the base of life on the Earth. If there would not have been greenhouse effect, life would not have been there. Because of the greenhouse effect, we are there. But this enhanced greenhouse effect is creating problem. And why this greenhouse effect is enhancing? Because of the certain gases, which are basically now more gases are there in the atmosphere. These are some of the greenhouse gases: carbon dioxide, then water, then N2O, then ozone, then methane, okay, then chlorofluorocarbons. These are the things which are being accumulated in the atmosphere, and they absorb energy for energy of long wave radiation, and later on they re-radiate. So some of the portion of that re-radiated energy is coming back to the Earth. So there is a cycle that Earth is radiating back to the atmosphere, and again atmosphere is redirecting some energy back. And that is creating basically the enhanced greenhouse effect, and that we call atmospheric warming. If the amount of greenhouse gas increase, the surface air temperature will increase. This is basically global warming. Now, how do we know that global warming is the cause of glacier melt, or you can say abnormal melt of glacier? First we have to see whether global warming is real thing or not, because there are some scientists who believe that it's basically hoax. That global warming is not there, and whatever climate change is happening, this is basically natural part. Now, let us take what we get carbon dioxide levels from the ice cores which are drilled from Antarctica. Now, you see, this is 400,000 years back. So you can say 4 lakhs years back. And this is the level of carbon dioxide. You can see here, overall level was 300 ppm or less. Okay, highest you can see around 300 ppm. Ppm is parts per million. Okay, and you know what is current status of carbon dioxide? It is around 413 or 414, that is the current. And you can see this current level of carbon dioxide was never there. Okay, so that is very clear that carbon dioxide in the atmosphere has increased a lot. Okay, but carbon dioxide is really triggering the atmosphere, air temperature or not. So the temperature anomalies and carbon dioxide levels, you can see CO2 parts per million volume, they are plotted here on y-axis, left side, and right side you can see temperature anomaly. Anomaly means with respect to normal, how much deviations are there. Now you can see that deviations are there 3 degree to minus 9 degree. Okay, this is 450,000 years back to, you can say, almost today. So there have been period of high carbon dioxide, low carbon dioxide, but those levels are very well matching with the temperature anomalies. When carbon dioxide is high, temperature anomaly is positive. And when carbon dioxide levels are low, temperature anomalies are negative with respect to the normal. These are basically, you can say, the ice ages. And they are called basically interglacial periods. These results are basically from the ice core from Vostok area in the Antarctica. Okay, so what we are interpreting, we are telling that there is very high correlation between carbon dioxide and temperature anomaly. But now there is a debate whether this temperature is triggering carbon dioxide or carbon dioxide is triggering temperature anomaly. It doesn't prove anything from there. Okay, but then it has been seen that there is lag. First, there is certain lag in temporal domain that temperature anomalies are following the carbon dioxide labels. Okay, now we have seen here there have been fluctuations in temperature. So why we are worrying about current temperature fluctuation? Currently also, if there are fluctuations, let it be there, it is natural. But then let us do some calculation. Now let us calculate the temperature anomaly gradient. Okay, now there is one point A, point B. Now this point A is when there is almost ice age. Okay, and this is basically interglacial. Now from here to here, 9,700 years. Okay, and what is the temperature difference? That is of around 12 degrees Celsius. So per year it is coming 0.0013 degrees Celsius. This kind of gradient we have seen earlier also. Now we are talking about the geological time scale. Okay, now let us come what is happening today for last 3-4 decades. This is the temperature deviations. Okay, now if I take one point here A, one point B here, and we do calculation. Now there is difference of 0.6 degrees Celsius in 30 years. So it is, this gradient is become 0.02 degrees Celsius. Now you compare 0.02 degrees Celsius per year and 0.0013 degrees Celsius. You see, these are the differences basically which are worrisome. So what does it tell? It tells that temperature deviation gradient is unprecedentedly high. Now there is no doubt that yes, climate change is happening, which is not normal. And these climate change are basically, they are affecting the glacier's status. Okay, now let us come back to glacier and water. How much water is there over? If I tell how much water is there over in the Earth system itself. So total volume of water on Earth is estimated around 1.39 billion kilometer cubic. And out of this, 97.5% is salty water. You can't directly use it. So only 2.5% is fresh water. And of this fresh, which is 2.5%, only 0.3% is in liquid form, rest is in solid form. Okay, now let us see this detail. You see here, this is total global water. So this fresh water is 2.5%. Then out of this 2.5%, groundwater is around 30%, and around 70% is in glacier and ice caps. And of that 1.2%, which is basically surface water or other fresh water, 1.2%, of that lakes, then ground ice and permafrost, and some water in atmosphere and some water in living things. This is the basically kind of a distribution of water over the earth. This is same thing. Okay, again, this, I don't know from where this box is coming. Sorry. Okay, so the same thing is here in tabular form, that how much volume of water is there and how much water is fresh water, how much water is salty water. This is in terms of, this is given in a table, and in different ocean and glaciers and groundwater. Now this is basically that overall mass balance, if you see, then so estimates of global glacier volume use various methods of volume area scaling. Okay, because you cannot go and measure each and everything. Now there is one inventory of glacier, that is Randolph Glacier Inventory, which is written in RGI. Based on that, if all those glaciers, if you remember, other than Greenland and Antarctica, all the glaciers, if they melt, it is estimated that around 40 centimeter sea level will increase. That is the all the glaciers which are there in RGI. Okay. Now let us go. Why I am not able to see my top? Sorry.
Sir, we are able to see this harvesting iceberg for water. We are able to see the top of your heading.
Okay, but then why I'm not, this why menu is coming there? Menu comes there, so I'm not able to read that. So sorry for the disturbance. Okay, so this we were talking about the glacier volume, and which was based on the RGI inventory. I think that again this box is coming now. You are able to see that box?
Yes, yes, it is.
I don't know why this box.
Now disappeared.
Now disappeared. Let us hope now it doesn't come later on. Okay, so we will further go ahead. Now, harvesting iceberg, as we have discussed, iceberg are basically parts of the broken parts of the ice shelf and ice sheets, and they are basically a store of fresh water. And you know, we are talking there is very less fresh water. And so why we should not use those iceberg as source of fresh water. So as I told you, although icebergs are floating over the salty water, which is basically ocean, but the ice has no salt in it because their origin is land, their origin is ice shelf, there is origin ice sheet, which is basically fresh water storage. So if you melt an iceberg, you will get drinkable fresh water. Icebergs have never been used as a major source of drinking water, but it is possible that near future you will be able, we will be able to use this iceberg as source of water. There are different news. You can see that iceberg harvesting is a swashbuckling new industry in Newfoundland and Labrador. Then they are writing here $166 water could dictate international iceberg law. The concept of using iceberg as a water source has been around for a time, for a long time. It has always been seen as something that is vaguely possible one day, but not in near future. Okay, now how are glaciers monitored? Okay, now there we can think the glaciers monitoring can be by traditional surveying. Then people can go do some expeditions there. Then nowadays we have got GPS system and we have got remote sensing data. But as I have shown you this figure earlier also, okay, this is the size of Antarctica, Antarctic ice sheet and Greenland ice sheet. We can't think of any traditional surveying method that we can really do monitoring of these glaciers in a spatial and temporal domain. And expeditions, obviously these places are not very accessible. They are not very easily accessible where you can do very frequent expeditions. Although we do frequent expeditions, we collect some data over there, but that data is not, you can say, exhaustive. And GPS, obviously installing in some such inaccessible area is not that feasible. So now remote sensing data, use of remote sensing data remains the only thing which you can use for monitoring of glaciers. Now, use of remote sensing comes. I think that box is again coming now.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah. You may just ignore.
Okay, so now I will go about for the optical remote sensing signatures. Now there are, if I plot X wavelength on X band and percentage reflectance on Y axis, you see that different land features, different are including water and snow and ice, they are having different kind of spectral signatures. Their variation with respect to wavelength are different. You can see dry soil, how it is increasing from there to there. Water has got very low value of reflectance. Oh no, it is increasing, yeah. I'm not able to remove that box. Okay, now the optical remote sensing signature for water, snow and ice. Why I have shown here three? Because whenever we talk of glacier, basically we have to talk of water, snow and glacier. And you can see that snow signatures, snow is basically highly reflecting thing. Then ice is relatively less reflecting thing and water reflect very less. Most of the energy is basically absorbed by the water. And similarly, we have to see emissivity. Because once remote sensing sensor, they work in reflective, they use reflective properties also, and they use emissivity of the target also. So emissivity of different targets also has to be studied. That black color, you can see this is emissivity of water at a different wavelength. Then ice you see in red color, and snow you see this a blue color. what you see that emissivity at a different wavelength is varying. These are the features we use for discriminating these things, water, snow, and ice, in different wavelengths. Thus, similarly, microwave remote sensing signature, if you see, so for first year or multi-year ice, which I have not explained right now, the ice which remain there at least for one summer, and it is existing later on, that is called basically multi-year ice, and the ice which is there only for 1 year, that is called first year ice. So the signatures of first year ice or multi-year ice and snow, they are shown here, and you can see their variation are different. Now this is the variation for first year ice, and this is multi-year ice, and this increasing trend is bottom. This gives the rationale for discrimination of these things. This is one example where remote sensing has been used for monitoring of iceberg. But I am talking about iceberg because, as I told you, this is part of broken part of glacier, and this is how we use remote sensing data. The name of sensors are written RISAT ones. Synthetic aperture radar data was also used for monitoring the iceberg. And there is one more example which I am showing, that how iceberg can be detected and monitored. And this was also done using Indian remote sensing data, RISAT-1, synthetic aperture radar data. And these names I have written basically just to show that SAC team detected these icebergs. They were not available. World was not knowing about these icebergs. They were detected and later on they were monitored by the sector. And how they are changing over the time, that I have shown in these pictures. Now I will run fast. So I will talk about the ice thickness over the Greenland. This is it gives an idea that how thick different parts of Greenland ice are there. You can see up to 3 kilometers. Here you can see legend, thickness goes up to 3 kilometers. Similarly, Antarctica, if you see, as I have told, at there is one place in Antarctica where ice thickness is around 4.9 kilometers, but average thickness is around 2 kilometers. And there is one study which has been done over 33 Antarctic glaciers sectors. Okay, and this is showing their velocity. Okay, ice is flowing. So you see here, it is up to 1.5 kilometer per year. That kind of ice flow is happening over the Antarctica. Now there are different studies which are being carried out using remote sensing data and modeling. So people are, scientists are deriving the ice velocity, scientists are estimating the ice thickness using remote sensing data and other data that like GPR and all those things. And there are some sensors which give idea of that how thick ice is there. And there is basically, this is showing mass balance in different parts of the Antarctica. Okay, now I'm running fast because I have seen this time is around 6:15. I was not knowing about the time. Now I have seen the time, so I'm running fast. Global glacier ice loss. This is one JGR paper which I have displayed here, and they have done a global study that different parts of globe, how ice loss is happening. This is the structure of their study, and what are their findings? That in Greenland ice sheet, there is loss of around 278 gigaton of ice per year. And Antarctica, this loss is of the order of 92 gigaton per year. and other than Greenland and Antarctica are land ice and caps. There is loss of around 162 gigaton. So that kind of ice loss is happening every year, and it is considered this is not basically normal melting. And that is the reason of worry that we have to do something. So what next? Thing is that we have to preserve our glaciers in their natural condition. So how to preserve? We have to stop melting. So this, can someone guess what is this? Basically, this is one photograph which is showing, although this is chinanews.com, but such kind of measures, these are basically blankets which are put there to cover the glaciers. So because of direct heat, glaciers don't melt, or you can say that melting is low. So to reduce that melting, high melting of glaciers, such measures are being taken at certain location of the glaciers, especially in Switzerland. And now recently I read some news that China has also started. They have carried out some studies to cover some of the glaciers by blankets so that they are able to reduce that glacier melting. This is another picture which is showing that by covering glaciers by white blankets, they are trying to stop, enhance the melting of the glaciers. Now you know that glacier harvesting, iceberg harvesting, then reducing that extra, or you can say enhanced melting of iceberg. There was one paper that Antarctic iceberg, how we can use for fresh water. And this, you know, it is a scientific study which was, you know, carried out in 1973. Just I am saying that it's not one decade or two decade. Very long back, we started that how to harvest glaciers, how to harvest iceberg for getting fresh water. At the same time, we have to see that we have to stop the enhanced melting of glaciers. These are some of the things which I have shown, like Mission 2012. This is basically MIT site, where they are writing sources of fresh water, how to use those. Then there are some studies from South Africa. These are some news also. Now, so I would like to summarize that getting fresh water from glacier or iceberg, it is very good thing. We should use. We can't ignore that, because to wherever there is scarcity of water, we have to use. But we have to apply a holistic approach. And what is that holistic approach? We have seen that glacier itself is a system. There is input, there is output, there are processes, and there is earth system. Now, glacier system and earth system cannot be treated separately. We have to integrate that glacier system into earth system, and holistic approach has to be taken. We have to understand different input of glaciers, their quantity, how much precipitation is happening, when is happening, so their distribution with respect to, and their quantity and quality, we have to understand well. Their distribution in space, we have to see the area also. We have to know their volume, their mass. And research is being done in that direction. But obviously, there are certain limitations. Right now, we are not able to quantify exact mass of any glacier, because right now, we are having some approximation of the three dimension of glaciers. And in time, now, past, we have got certain idea, but obviously we have to predict also. If climate change keep on happening like this, and what kind of climate change are happening, so what will be the status of our glaciers, that predictions we should be able to do. Then we have to spread awareness. Now, awareness is not that you make one person aware and your work will be done. No, awareness has to be from local scale to global scale. and global that glacier processes has to be understood. Now, right now we are having access to the surface only. Subsurface we are not very much aware, but we have to understand the subsurfaces process also. We have to understand the distribution of output, and we have to understand the interaction of glacier with other earth system. And then whatever knowledge we are having, whatever observations we are having, we have to convert this into policy at a different level, and that implementation has to be done. Without implementation, without action, basically this, whatever our worry is about the glacier, we will not be able to solve it. So that's all from my end. But before ending this lecture, I will thank once again ITRA, and I will thank Indian Space Research Organization Space Application Center, because they gave me an opportunity to go to, you know, Arctic, to the Antarctic, and I have been in Himalayan glaciers. So basically, if you tell people, tell there are three poles: Arctic, Antarctic, the North Pole, South Pole, and third pole is basically Himalaya. So I am lucky that I have been to all the three poles. I have basically, I can say, I have interacted with glaciers in the Arctic, in the Antarctic, and the Himalaya. Some of, although academically I am not a geologist, but okay, by experience I have studied some of the glaciers in the Alpine glacier, and you can say in the ice sheet terms, in the sea ice also I have studied. So thank you very much. I thank all the participants to hearing it. Thank you very much.
Many thanks, Dr. Rajak. It was an excellent and so interesting and informative talks. It is well expressed. The slides were so beautiful, and you took us to that awesome glaciated terrains, and every slide has given us new insight, new information, and of course this new visualization about the aspects related to glaciers. And we also learned that glaciers are equally important. And if we have to maintain the sustainability of our water resources, then glacier needs to be studied in much more details. And there is still lots of the research and lots of work needs to be done. But thanks a lot once again to introduce us about this vast areas. And now I will invite any question, or if there is no other questions, then I will also at the same time open it for the discussion. So I also invite all the panel members that they can start asking the questions or for any comments.
Yes.
Uncle, my name is Raini Sani. I have a doubt that how was your experience on both the poles, North Pole and South Pole?
Hi. Oh, thank you very much for asking such question. I'll tell, as far as experience is concerned, I'll tell, it was superb in the Arctic, in the Antarctic, and the Himalaya. But I will tell, there are some differences. Like when you go to Himalaya, there is basically scarcity of, you can say air is thin. And because of thin air, you have lot of trouble in, you know, breathing. But that kind of problems you don't face when you go to Arctic and Antarctic. But when you go to Arctic and Antarctic, there are different kind of problems. And you see that entirely different kind of terrain there. Like when I was there in Antarctica, and when I was there in one ice sheet, then hundreds of kilometers, there is only white, all around white, and sky was blue. So that white terrain was, you know, meeting with a blue sky, and you are not able to judge where really horizon is there. So that kind of feelings are there. and it has been very nice experience in Antarctica or Arctic or. Thank you.
Can I have a question, sir?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Please go.
Okay, Dr. Rajat, you have given a very nice information in respect of the global situation about the glaciers and related scientific data also. But could you also tell us something about our own glaciers in India, because there has been very little emphasis or highlighting. So maybe very briefly, if you like, because you see, we would be immediately concerned with our glaciers and the water resources on which we are banking upon the glaciers. If you could very briefly tell us, I think it would be useful for the entire audience. Thank you.
Right. Sir, yes, you are right. Just I have shown only that there are many glaciers in the Himalayas, and you might be, and maybe you are reading in some newspaper that even in Himalayas also, there is a lot of glacier retreat happening. And there are some, like even I have gone to two of the glaciers, that Khardung Glacier and Chipa Glacier, and we have carried out studies, and we found that yes, those glaciers are retreating. And there are many studies, whether you take Gangotri Glacier, whether you take Chota Sigri Glacier, and my teammates like Susil has also gone to many glaciers. Then we have got many scientists in our Space Application Center. They have visited a number of glaciers. And retreat is there. But somehow what we found, the kind of retreat probably is happening in Alps or some Arctic glaciers. That kind of retreat is not there in our Himalayan glaciers. And Himalayan glaciers also, there are different sections where retreat is more and where retreat is less. Even there are number of glaciers which are advancing. Advancing is just opposite of glaciers. But overall, there is retreat of glacier even in Himalaya also.
So how does it impact the water availability scenario? Actually, because for most of the extra peninsular rivers, the glaciers are the source of water, the melting of the glaciers. And once you say retreat means we are permanently losing part of the source. Is it implied like that?
Yes, sir. So thing is that if we don't do anything, and if these glaciers keep on retreating like this or with enhanced rate, then what is going to happen? Right now, initially, there will be melt of glacier and there will be more runoff in the rivers. And initially, there will not be less a lack of water in the rivers because of the extra melting of the glaciers. But what will happen, as I have shown earlier, that a time will come when volume of the glacier will reach to a stage when melting will decrease. When melting will decrease, the overall volume of water which is going in the rivers, which are fed by those glaciers, will reduce. And the people who are dependent on those glacier, that river water, obviously they will suffer. Now, right now, I don't have any quantification of that water that I don't have any exact quantification that how many people, but there are news that, millions of people will be affected because of this.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yes, please. Any other question? Yes. Unmute your... Yes, Himanshu, thanks.
Yeah. I have two questions to ask.
Yes, sir.
Should I go ahead?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, Rajakji, I want to know basically the average life of a glacier. You have already told so many things. How much it will be? Whether any glacier which is existing... we can say it will be for 100 years, 10 years, based on its volume or remote sensing studies, how much it will be? Or any is there any new formation of glaciers?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sir, if you ask average glacier life, I don't know whether anyone has estimated it or not. But thing is that the first glacier, it is estimated. It is based on certain models. that first glacier was formed some 34 million years ago. 34 million years ago on Antarctica. Mm. And the glaciers are alpine glaciers. Basically, they also started forming some 10 or 12 million years ago. So,
okay.
But, so average life, you tell, basically it will be in millions of years, average.
Millions of years.
But, yeah, but there are some glaciers which have already disappeared.
Okay.
Correct. And as I have shown very first, in initial slides, the youngest glacier, basically it got formed after 1980 only. But thing is that it is still existing. If you ask the age of that glacier, basically age of that glacier is only 40 years. So now you can see the range of glacier age. One glacier, you can say 34 million years. And this there is a glacier which is 40 year old. Average, but obviously average will come in millions of years.
Okay, the 40 years old glacier, is there any study means how much the size is increasing? If the size is increasing, we can say its life is in, life will increase.
No.
If it is decreasing, then we can say the life will reduce.
No. Somehow that glacier is increasing, sir.
Okay.
That glacier is there in USA, in Washington region. And because, you know, that there was basically one volcano mound, and around that volcano mound, that glacier has come up. And they found that 1980s only, they thought, okay, that glacier has come up there. Otherwise, it was not there. I have shown that 1980 picture also.
Hmm.
And I read somewhere in on net only that the size of that glacier is increasing. It is not decreasing. But that depends that the terrain of that glacier and the region of that glacier and... basically, people write that because that glacier, a lot of region of that glacier is in shadow. So there is no direct radiation falling on that glacier. Probably that is why it is not retreating. But other glaciers are retreating.
My question, Rajak, to you is regarding the Greenwich.
Yes.
You know, the Greenwich land which you have said about it.
Yeah, yes.
You know, like it was, in our lifetime only about 40 years back or 50 years back, we were knowing that this is a total, you know, like as a it is a full of ice, but lately, you know, like it has come that the, you know, lot of ice is melting there. You know, you are seeing, you are able to see the earth part also. You are able to see some of islands also there, and because of that, they find that water into the Europe or some sea areas increasing. So even then, now you are saying this is about 3 kilometer high. It means still, you know, like the situation there is getting worsened, but is not to that extent, or it is still, you know, like because of that only people are really scared of the global warming.
Sir, yes, you are talking about the Greenland glaciers. So one is that Greenland glaciers are melting, they are retreating, there is no doubt. There is a lot of study, there are many observations which clearly tell there are evidences that glaciers in the Arctic and glaciers around Greenland, they are melting a lot. And because of that, obviously, whenever there is melting of glacier or melting of ice sheet, there will be increase in sea level. So sea level is increasing, there is no doubt. But thing is, how much it is increasing? As there is one estimate, if all the glaciers, including your ice sheets, now ice sheet, when I'm telling, so basically Greenland ice sheet also and Antarctica also, if all the glaciers melt, around 70 meter sea level will increase. It's a basically theoretical, because we don't know when this all the ice sheet will melt. Because it will take thousands of years to melt all the ice, thousands of years. Not, but there are certain glaciers which may melt in coming decades or some more glaciers in coming century. But it is expected that all the glaciers may not disappear in thousands of years. It will take, but whenever an estimate, if all the ice sheet and all the glaciers melt away, then sea level will increase by 70 meter, and 70 meter is a very large number for, as far as sea level is concerned, because lot of area of the, you know, our land mass will be submerged.
So that is fine. I am saying that is still, I think in the last 30, 40 years, the sea level has increased by among 20 mm or 30 mm or 40 mm. I don't know.
Yes,
sir. I read somewhere.
Yeah, it is. Yes, you are right. It is in mm and mm.
Yeah.
Right. It is in mm only. But yeah, so it is increasing. There is no doubt. And glaciers are retreating. There is no doubt. But Himalayan glaciers are not retreating that fast. The kind of glacier melt is happening in the Arctic, that I was telling you.
It was a nice presentation, though so much of a research in that, very difficult to understand for, you know, like general public like us. But I think it is quite informative because it is available on YouTube. I think I have to once again go through it and see more focus on reading your slides.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thanks. Any other question?
Himanshu?
Yeah.
Sir, can we drink iceberg water directly or after some purification?
Iceberg water is fresh water. You can simply melt it and you can drink it. And when we were there in Antarctica, we have basically taken that snow water. Because snow is there, we have eaten the snow, you can say, because it's a fresh. So there is no problem. In fact, you might have seen in some of my slides that people are planning some business out of that iceberg.
Yes.
They want
but
to...
It will not have any salt.
Yeah, it will not have. Sir, I told about sea ice. Na? Sea ice is basically formed over the sea or ocean surface, and that is salty. But icebergs are not salty.
Thanks.
Thanks, sir.
So I have just one question about that the glacier, the source of water. Do we have some number about our Himalayan rivers? What's the percentage of the river discharge in those river is coming from the glacier? Or season-wise, because in summer it will be different, in winter it will be different.
Yes, it will be different in different season. And some people, you are aware that in a Space Application Center also, some people are working that hydrology of that Himalayan basins. But right now I don't have any number. I cannot give any quantity. But people are working and people are trying to estimate that how much right now melt is there and what kind of melt is expected in future. But
Vikrant.
Yes.
Exact quantitative number may not be there, but there are reports that almost 30 to 50% of the runoff or discharge is contributed because of snow and glacier melt runoff.
That is the summer period or the average annual discharge?
This is for average. And average. If you see that, actually it may be very difficult to discriminate the melt runoff by snow and by glacier because they together contribute in that process. So, but overall, like if we see the runoff discharge for this Himalayan region, it is reported to approximately around 30 to 50%. It varies from, like, winter contribution from snow will be more. And if we go for this ablation period, then contribution from glacier ice will be more. But approximately half of that it could reach because of the snow and glacier melt runoff.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Any other question, query, or comments? As we will move to our next phase. So I once again thanks Dr. Ram Rajak, and it's our time to felicitate for his excellent talk and
I request our ITRA president, Sri Mathur sir, to say a few words, and I think this time to have a small clapping for. So I request Mathur sir that on behalf of ITRA, he say a few words. So I think this slide is visible. So once again, then I thanks Professor Rajak for this excellent talk, such informative, and the slides were so beautiful. I mean, it was the e-slides had the lots of information, and as CTG has suggested that we will again go through the YouTube channel and see those beautiful slides, and we'll understand more about the glaciers. Now tomorrow we will our last talk will be by Dr. Sushil Singh on the climate change and the water resources, and tomorrow at the same time. So I again invite all of you to join using the same Zoom link and understand the bigger aspect of the introduction has already been discussed using the climate change. The climate change has many more aspects related to water resources. Tomorrow we will learn again.
Yeah, Vikrantji, I just want to add one thing.
Yes, please.
That it will be on snow cover and climate change, the another aspect of our this solid water.
So thanks for the details and the project. Yeah. So then we will listen about the snow melt and the climate change impact. On our river, which is especially very important for the Himalayan rivers.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, all the participants.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Pram Pratik. I think it was a really excellent time which we are having.
Okay, goodbye to all.
Goodbye, sir. Bye.